So all you got to do is watch CNN this morning. They've got this constant headline about how basically Sondland yesterday outed the president, when we know, of course, that's the furthest thing from the truth. All you got to do is watch that to come to the realization there's only one place to go for news. There's only one. Not even Fox News anymore. I got news for you.
No, it's true.
Only one. BillO'Reilly.com. He was always the best. He still is the best, and he'll be the best because he just is. His new column is out, The Spectacle. It's excellent. His interviews and shows at BillO'Reilly.com are every bit as good as it was when he was on The Factor. He's still, in my opinion, and Bernie's opinion, the best newsman in the business today. He's got a big show coming up December 15th in Huntington. We're both going to be there. We can't wait. His book on Trump is kicking ass still, weeks and weeks and weeks since its release. He is the man, and he's here for his regular Thursday visit, our good buddy, Bill O'Reilly.
Big Bill.
Hey, I'm trying to picture a book kicking somebody's butt. It's an image that I'm formulating right as we speak. I appreciate all the nice words you guys always say about me. A couple of things right from the jump. I have an interview with President Trump that I'm going to do on Monday. First radio interview ever. As far as sitting down for an extended period of time, which will run on WABC. Thanksgiving at noon.
Wow.
So we break that here on the Bernie and Sid Show.
Excellent.
Nice.
It's going to be on about 600-700 stations across country. As you guys know, I do a 15-minute news radio wrap every day called the O'Reilly Update. And so we're real pleased with that because I got lots of questions for Mr. Trump. Last night, I made it halfway through the Democratic debate, and I have two questions for you guys.
Sure.
Okay? Number one, do you remember anything that any of the candidates said in that debate?
The part where, Biden said that the only black senator to endorse me, female black senator, was Carol Mosley Braun, where he put his foot in his mouth. I remember that.
That was one. And then for me, of course, when he talked about, you know, minimizing the misconduct towards women in this country, and he used the word punch.
We got to keep punching at it.
We remember the gaffes, Bill.
So I don't know who that writer was who gave him that line, but maybe we want to have a talk with him.
Absolutely.
Okay. Do you remember any hard questions by the four female moderators?
No. Absolutely not.
Oh, God, no. In fact, Rachel Maddow started off serving up the biggest softball I've ever heard in my whole life.
Well, you know, I just think that she should be wearing a big shirt. I hate Trump, and I hate Trump, and like 5-6 times. That's all.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there, and I'm going, okay, so this is how far we've fallen in this country. So you get four debate moderators, and over a two-hour period, not one hard question.
Not one.
Nope. So I tweet out, I'm not learning anything here, not one thing, and I didn't. No questions about gun violence, open borders, drug addiction, socialism downside, unlimited abortion, or any other topic where Democrats are challenged by public opinion. Not one. Now, here's the headline. The fix was in. As I told BillO'Reilly.com viewers last night on the No Spin News, I predicted not one question to Joe Biden about Ukraine. And you can understand because the four moderators were all Democrats, one from the Washington Post, three from NBC, all committed Democrats, not just kind of, well, I lean that way. No. But you would think that the other candidates trying to knock Biden off would say, hey, Joe, I'm a little foggy about your son getting, all these millions of dollars. Can you explain that to me?
Of course.
Not one. And you know why? I had a report yesterday, and I don't like anonymous sources, but somebody called me and said, you watch, the word is out from the hierarchy. The hierarchy of the Democratic Party is Nancy Pelosi, Chuck Schumer, and a few money men, people who raise money for the party. They basically sent to all the candidates, don't ask Biden anything about Ukraine. No Ukraine questions. And you got none the whole night. Now, think about it. Step back and think about it. This is the biggest story, Ukraine, involving Trump and Biden, in the country right now. All right? They're devoting hours and hours and hours, and not one question.
Exactly.
Not one.
No.
So this points to the unbelievable corruption of our journalistic system and our political system. when you don't have one candidate who wants to gain by Biden losing, all right? Not one. Not Warren, not Sanders. Nobody turns to him and says, hey, you want to explain this to me, Joe? And this doesn't look good to us. Not one.
No, the fix is in. No awkward questions for our fellow travelers up on the stage there. None of that from the four ladies who, by the way, should have been wearing the pea hats, that they wore at the marches because essentially, I mean, that's...
the little hats, that's right.
Yeah,
that would have been great.
Exactly.
This gets me angry. I'm sitting here going, it's just not right what's happening to the country. Do we have no honesty at all?
Nope.
None? And the answer is no, we don't. We don't. Now, the good news is 11 million people watched the impeachment. There are 330 million people in the country. So they're not engaged. The folks aren't engaged. But the bad news is that the other 319 million who didn't watch the impeachment yesterday have to rely on the corrupt media to tell them what happened.
Right.
Because they didn't see it.
Exactly. That's the problem. The media is poisoning them.
Let me throw one more thing in here, and I hope I'm not bloviating too much.
No, it's perfect.
Okay. I know all these journalists. I know them all right? And I know that because Donald Trump has attacked many of them personally and mocked them personally in tweets and statements, that they hate him so much that it's not even close anymore to getting honest analysis or reportage. And that is such a dangerous situation. And when I see the president, I'm going to tell him. I'm going to say, look, I know you want to give your base your point of view, and I know you want to call people out you don't believe are being fair and honest, but that the level of hatred now has reached an unhealthy proportion. And anything you can do to get a little bit of detente would be better for the country.
Absolutely. And, Bill, it's just, it's incredible that they don't ask these questions. Look, they don't ask why do you think other candidates are thinking of jumping into the race, like Mike Bloomberg, Deval Patrick just got in? What's wrong with you people? Anything awkward that would hurt them, they're not going to ask.
I could do a pay-per-view with me and those 10 people, and I think I could make about $50 million.
All right?
Let's do it.
It'd be like those prize fights that nobody ever heard of these people from Panama come in, but people watch it because they like violence. Well, this wouldn't be violence, but each one of them, I think they're each one of them very interesting people, I have to say. Everyone on that stage last night, I feel, is an interesting person. But you're not learning anything about them. All right, they are parroting the same thing. Bernie Sanders, they didn't even ask him any questions because he says the same thing.
Yep.
And there are more debates coming. So all I would do is say, look, Bernie, we don't really have any questions for you, but to be fair, we're just going to rerun some of your answers that you gave in the past.
It's true. He says the same thing every single time.
Every time. It's a revolution. Bernie, you're not going to get elected. They don't want you. They've never wanted you. It's not going to happen.
But I'll tell you something. There is something charming, Bill, about that, in that, as crazy as he is, and he's insane and dangerous, and you've written about him a million times, and it's always right, at least he stands by his convictions. I mean, Liz Warren changes. This one changes.
He's a true believer.
That's a very good observation, Sid. I have always said that. I have nothing but admiration for Bernie Sanders' fanaticism. I admire his fanaticism. Because he honeymooned in Russia.
Yes.
Okay. So, you see, they go get married, they go to Russia. Honey, would you like to take a walk? It's 18 below zero. No. You dragged me over here. Why? There's no Disneyland. There's no beach. Why are we here? Well, there's the Statue of Lenin right over there. Can we take a picture of you in front of it? I mean, this is the honeymoon. So the man is absolutely consistent.
No doubt about it.
De Blasio, too, in Cuba. So one of the questions I'd like to ask you, Bill, when you stop by, is the week that was for Trump. Now, we're looking at it like this. The impeachment hearings have been a complete dud. Win for Donald Trump. Democrat debate last night, complete dud. win for Donald Trump. Donald Trump in Texas yesterday, new Apple store opening there, big deal, win for Donald Trump. So for guys like us who tend to support Trump and Bernie especially, we think it's been a pretty good week, but I've heard time and time again this week, it's been a bad week for Trump. So which one is it?
I don't think the impeachment is good for Trump because he hasn't done what he needs to do to turn it to his favor. And I think we discussed this last time I was on your program. 10 minutes, he's sitting in the Oval Office, the television camera on him, he explains why he did what he did in Ukraine. Look, I got it in the United States of Trump, and that was long before any of this controversy. He's obsessed, he believes that the Obama administration tried to undermine his campaign and his presidency, and he is obsessed with exposing it. That's what the story's about.
And
just say it. Just say it. Say, I'm the president. I believe this happened. I want this out. I think you're going to see it with the Horowitz report coming out in December and then with the Justice Department criminal investigation in the spring. But I wanted Ukraine to cooperate with American authorities and investigate corruption. You're going to kick me out for that?
Right.
All he has to do. Then he uses this whole thing to his advantage. But right now, as I said, most Americans don't know what the deuce is going on.
No, they don't. They're not engaged. They're apathetic. But sadly, they're getting their information from this media, this corrupt media, as you point out, Bill, which is brainwashing them into thinking something happened.
It's not really working. And Gallup's got a poll out today. Job performance of Trump up 2 points since the impeachment hearings at 43. I mean, that's not a bad job performance when you've got, you know, the Democratic Party and the media allied together, no doubt about it, trying to get the guy booted out of office. He's still got 43% of the country saying he's doing a pretty good job. So Trump is not in a precarious place right now. He's not going to be removed from office, and he may well get reelected, but he's not seizing, all right, the advantage that he could seize.
Uh-huh.
If he followed my advice, and that's for everyone on the planet, not just Donald Trump.
We look forward to hearing that interview on Thanksgiving Day that you're going to do on Monday where you can give him that advice.
I'm not going to give him the advice. If he asks me, I will.
Okay.
Right. But I'm not intrusive like that.
Well, a week from, today.
Yeah, a week from today, before the turkey dinner. All right, settle into WABC, noon, and you'll hear a kick-butt interview.
Can't wait.
Bill's going to be at the Paramount in Huntington. Understanding Trump is the show on December 15th. Sid and I will be there. The United States of Trump is the book, the website, and the podcast at BillO'Reilly.com. Bill, thank you very much.
All right, always fun, guys. Thanks for having me.
You were great. You really were. Bill O'Reilly, you're the absolute best. Bernie and Sid, live this morning and every morning from the NJ.com studios.